Revelation 2:4, and that's what we just want to open with tonight, because the Lord reminded me that we have not lost our first love. He is our first love. And so Revelation 2:4 is, John is writing about the church at Ephesus. He says, "This I have against you, that you have lost your first love." So tonight what we declare is that we have not lost our first love, that we are in love with Jesus Christ, our Savior, and we are here to worship His great name tonight. So Heavenly Father, Lord, we just praise You, Adonai. We just declare that You are King of Kings. You are Lord of Lords. You are the beginning. You are the end. Lord, You are the rock that we stand upon. Lord, You are the keeper and the lover of our souls. Lord, You are the lifter of our heads. And tonight, Father, what we want to do is we just say, we just surrender ourselves. Lord, we just give ourselves up to You. We just say, take us over. We just say, overcome us, Lord. We say, overwhelm us, Lord. We say, we offer up our bodies as a living and holy sacrifice to You tonight. And we just declare that You are our first love. We praise Your great name. In Jesus' holy name, I pray tonight. Amen.
Church, You know, I am so thankful that we know that our band is human and that we all make mistakes. I mean, for instance, I was looking around the room and there's some of us who stepped outside, noticed the weather, made the same decision of wearing shorts, and some of you made the mistake of wearing pants. And that's okay, because we're all human. But on a more serious note, it just reminded me of some of the teachings that I've read over and looked over. And one pastor and theologian back during World War II, Nazi Germany, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, wrote a book. And in that book, he was talking about how we struggle with this fake division in our mind, where we somehow think that the spiritual automatically equals good and the fleshly, the physical, automatically equals bad, where that's not taught in the Bible at all. In fact, quite the opposite. For what we know is that everything is subsumed and assumed in Christ. God, when he came in the form of Christ, came in the flesh, giving his divine approval of what he had created, and yet his divine rejection of its sinfulness on the cross. And so Bonhoeffer goes on to talk about this weird tension we live in, where just because we're doing something that we think is quote-unquote spiritual doesn't necessarily mean it's good. And just because we're participating in something that is quote-unquote physical does not mean necessarily it's bad. Rather, it's all subsumed and submitted to Christ. And I could not help but think as we are sharing that laughter, you know, just enjoying the moment, the joy of the moment shared with one another, we think, this isn't very spiritual. We need to begin serious. But that's a serious moment of joy from God where we can laugh and enjoy fellowship together. So going forward, let's just think about that. The next time you make a mistake or what you think is a mistake, maybe you need to step back and think, man, God's just trying to point out that everything is his. Amen. Everything is his. Right. So let's go to prayer before we do offering. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much that you are the God who gives every good gift. Lord, you are the one who owns everything under heaven and above it. You've created it all. It's all yours. You've come down, you haven't rejected it. You came down to earth to buy it back for yourself. And you did not just buy back the creation, but you bought back the sinful people who are in it. And we are that people who have been sealed by the Holy Spirit to be set apart as your own possession. Not that you didn't already own us, but we are doubly yours now, Lord. And man, may that give us a greater joy in every moment, whether it's just a moment at home with family or a moment of laughter in the church as we mess up and goof up like we all do, or if it's a serious moment of your word coming to us to convict our lives, may we submit that all to Christ, all for his glory. And Lord, we thank you so much for being gathered here again. I pray that you be with us as we are here. Be with those who are not able to attend right now. I pray that you would continue to draw them back here so that they may be the body of Christ with us. We thank you and we praise you. And the church said, amen. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Overwhelming, never ending.
that will ever. your Holy Spirit. We just welcome him here tonight, Lord. We just ask him to have freedom in this place, to free us from the world, to free us from ourselves. Lord, move on our hearts tonight. Lord, we worship you, God. As your word comes forth, may it just pour out. May it be anointed. May it flow out of Glenn's mouth, from your heart into our spirits, God, and raise us up. Lord, raise us up that we would rise, that we would rise in this world and be a light. In Jesus' name I pray tonight.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much, Brother Jack, for your welcome. You know, so spot on for tonight's message. I love that, because everything we do, it's always, more or less, it's appraised through Christ. God sees it through Christ, and that's so amazing. Whether it's in the physical or the spiritual, it's always appraised through Christ. You know, it kind of reminds me of, you know, Jesus healing the man on the Sabbath, you know. And of course, all the religious men were going and getting on him, like, hey, you know, would you not help a person, you know, on the Sabbath, you know? And so everything is seen through how Christ sees it for our lives. And so it's really in step with our message today. I titled it, God titled it, A Journey Together, because we've been going through these messages since Resurrection Sunday, about getting close to God and being the church of freedom and growing together and coming along together, right, and being on this journey together. And so there's been many since on Resurrection Sunday may have received Christ for the first time. Maybe they watched these messages online, or maybe here or as well have rededicated their lives to Christ. And that's always such a wonderful thing, to rededicate, to be revived and restored in Christ Jesus, and on this journey. We're all together on this, and not putting all this pressure on each other. But man, there's nothing more wonderful than seeing a group of believers who were always desiring the presence of God, you know, being in the presence of God, being the presence of God together, being in his word together, worshiping God together, and encouraging each other and talking about Jesus together. And you see so much growth and spiritual growth come from that, from just wanting to be together in God's presence. It's amazing how much Jesus can do with his people from just enjoying to be with him. It's a perfect picture of him being on this earth. He enjoyed being with people. He enjoyed being in their presence, and the people enjoyed being in presence with him, who was God, who is God. And you see how they changed so much in their lives just from sitting down with the Lord. And so it's so amazing when you give people that freedom and just bringing people along, right? And just, I love that. It's nothing more, as a pastor, I love seeing everyone as you're getting to know each other and you're hanging out together and just talking about Christ, talking about his word, sharing life together, talking how their lives have been changed, talking about what God's done for them that day. And just, you see so much in-depth growth and maturity, right? You see a person grow in their maturity and in their faith, that they're not upset about every little thing that happens, or they're not, you know, they didn't get their way, or this color with the church pews or the church chairs. And, you know, all those things are just not to worry about. They grow in their faith and in their walk. So this journey together, we would, you know, those who are coming along and are rededicated or maybe coming along, so they're like, they may be asking, so what's my part in all this? You know, what do I need to be doing through this journey that we're in all together and that the church is bringing each other along? And so we could ask ourselves three things about a journey together. The first maybe would say, what's our goal? What's our goal and what's our destination? Well, we know our destination is heaven, right? To be in glory with the Lord. But our goal is to what? Become more like Christ, right? My life has been changed. I want to continue to change. I want to continue to be more like Christ. A lot of us just say, I want to be a better person. You know, I'm not the person I used to be, right? I want to continue to be more like Christ. I want to continue seeking His presence and glory, all right? Number two would be, well, how do we get there? Okay, that's a great question. So we know that how do we get there to our destination? Well, we're doing life together. We are a church body. We're a church family. We're in God's Word together. We're in prayer together. We're growing in the Lord together. And so that's our, His Word is always sets the standard for our paths to get there, right? It all always comes back to the Word of God and the truth of the Word. It's all based on His Word. And we know that I love it how, you know, Peter, again, was when Jesus was washing his feet, he's like, just wash all of me, Lord. And he says, you're really clean by the words I've spoken to you. And that's so amazing about the Word of God. When I need cleansing, when I need a restoring help in my life, when I need the encouragement, when I'm feeling down or I feel like I have just failed, I get into the Word of God. It's so amazing. Man, Stacy, we're talking about, there is, if there was one thing we could put our hand on, as we were talking, I think we were talking about this last weekend, it is the Word of God. It is the infallible Word of God that is just so amazing for being in a walk with God. It is everything to the Christian. It is everything to us because it is the truth. It is His Word. It is what He said that it's what we live on. It's out of every word that proceeds forth out of the mouth of God. It's His Word. It's not by bread alone that we live. So our goal, how do we get there, right? Our goal, our destination, how do we get there? The third question we would say, and I think this is the most important for all of us, and I think we all want to know it, is how do we stay on the course? How do we stay on that journey? You know, right? There's nothing worse than getting lost or you know, like there's nothing worse than GPSs today that they'll take you to a place that, you know, it doesn't look anything like where, you know, it will reroute you. It will take you off course. Like, this is not where I was wanting to go. And sometimes that gets messed up. But staying on course, it's such a huge thing for us. And I believe it's got to be one of the most important for Christians that they want to do. I don't think there's a Christian out there that likes getting off course. I don't think that there's a believer that enjoys it, that I believe that they put more pressure on themselves and don't need pressure from anyone else a lot of times. They need the help of God to stay on course. And there's all kinds of distractions out there to try to get us off course. Paul talked about it in epistles all the time. Jesus talked about it, right? And so some of the times we are in, we have gotten so many people wondering about their course, right? These times we've gone through with this coronavirus and a lot of people are asking, where are we at in God's calendar? Where are we at? Is Jesus returning? What's going on? Are we being judged? This is God? And then all these questions. And so if we're not careful, they kind of scoot us off course a little bit and we stop and we don't have our eyes on the prize. We don't focus, we don't keep the main thing, right? And so, and we know that there's distractions out there, but Paul in 2 Thessalonians has such great words in chapter 2 for believers. And they were going through this same, even back then, they're like, well, is this the day the Lord's coming back? Are we in the last days? And the believers in Thessalonians were doing the same. And Paul does such a beautiful job. He was not only a beautiful writer, and those are great things, but you know what? He was anointed by the Spirit of God. That's what made his writing so special, right? Man, you think about Jesus, you know, when he stood up, you know, in that synagogue, and they handed him the book of Isaiah. You know, and he says, the Spirit of God is upon me. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to set the captives free, to heal the sick, to let the blind see, right? And he said, today this prophecy has been fulfilled in your hearing. And everyone was just astonished at the gracious words that fell from his lips. He wasn't telling people, this is how you got to do this, and you got to do this, and you got to be that. Hey, they had been getting that from the religious teachers all those years in the synagogue, and they were falling asleep. And for a change, someone had given them exciting words to hear. And it was Jesus himself saying, I'm setting the captives free. I'm giving you life. I'm healing you. I'm going to open your eyes. And the Spirit of God is upon me. And the people were amazed. He was Christ himself. And this is really what Paul's doing here. He's just reaffirming the people who they are in Christ. Just as Jack said earlier, everything is appraised and goes through Christ. But look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1 and 2. It says, now we request you, brethren, with regard to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, that you not be quickly shaken from your composure, or be disturbed either by a spirit or a message or a letter that is not from us, to the effect that the day of our Lord has come. So see, they were trying to focus on then. Is this the day he's coming? Are we in the last days? Are these things happening because Christ is coming? Where are we at? And he's like, hey, don't lose your composure. Don't be quickly shaken. All right? He says, don't be disturbed because this could come from another spirit, or this could be writings from someone else besides us that Paul's saying. These letters aren't from us that you're hearing these things, right? So he's saying, stay on course is basically what he's saying, right? Stay on the course that you're on. And we're going to show what this course looks like and how God so miraculously involves us in his course he has us on. And it's a beautiful thing that he has done for us. But he's saying, keep your composure. Now, composure in the Greek, it's like, it would mean always seek things divinely. In other words, seek to have, in other words, it would be like, I want to meditate on Christ or on God while I'm on these things that might want to shake me up or may get me off course. I want to hear from what the Lord says through his Spirit. In other words, appraise everything through the Spirit of God. What is God telling me? So a lot of times we hear things, or in these days we're in, what do we want to do? We want to get on Google, right? What's going on in these days? You know, what's all about this coronavirus stuff? And is this a conspiracy? And is this to do this and this? And I get a lot of emails, and I get a lot of books that are referred to me and a lot of articles to me as a pastor that, hey, read this and read that, and you know, and I will, but I find one thing a lot of times is these people who are trying to explain these times we're in, that they're off on Scripture. That I'll find Scripture verses that they're using that they're out of context, and they're not even what the Word of God's saying, or they've twisted it. And I'm like, ooh, that's not... That is not what that verse says. And they've got that messed up. And I'm like, so these are letters, as Paul says, hey, don't be disturbed by a spirit or a message or a letter from somebody else. Stay on course. And so that's what a lot of times you're getting, messages or letters from somebody else. It's what they think. Maybe they're not from the Spirit of God, right? And so he wants us to stay on this course because there's a goal for our lives. We're all growing together, and it's just as Jesus is just sitting down with his people as he did walking this earth. Hey, come do life with me. Come let me be in your presence. Come let me share what I'm doing for you today. Come talk about my word together. Just enjoy worshiping together. Be in prayer together. Right? And it's all about centered around Christ. But I love how these things must be taught, shared with us through the Father or from the Father. If you look with me in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, it's so good. Let's see, verse 14 and 15 and 16. It says, but a natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. So a natural man doesn't accept the things of the Spirit of God. Isn't that amazing? Look what else he says. For they are foolishness to him. That's why we want to keep, that's how we keep our composure is what he's saying. Keep your composure. It must be appraised by the Holy Spirit. If you want to stay and keep your composure in check, then let everything be appraised by the Holy Spirit. Ask the Father, ask Jesus, the Holy Spirit to share with you or to give you comfort or peace or what you're struggling in. Like, why would you go to another source but the main source? Right? Because the natural man, it's foolishness. The natural man doesn't even accept what is of the Spirit of God. It's foolishness to him. He says, and he cannot understand them because they are spiritually appraised. So a natural man can't even understand what God's trying to say. Verse 15, but he who is spiritual appraises all things. So he's saying if you're spiritual, be spiritual, but he appraises all things through the Holy Spirit is what he's saying. And all things, everything about life. Do you do that? It don't matter if you're on your job, your grocery store, or where you're at, or you're driving, are you meditating with the Father? Are you seeking the Holy Spirit? He can share so much about life, no matter what you're doing, what you're participating, what you're reading. It's so amazing how the Holy Spirit wants to be involved, but he always wants to comfort you, give you peace through it. And he does it wonderfully. Says, yet he himself is appraised by no one, for who has known the mind of the Lord that he will instruct him, but we have the mind of Christ. Isn't that cool? We have the mind of Christ. Why would you go anywhere else to try to have comfort or peace or to know where we're at? We have the mind of Christ. Every which on one of us have received Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. He has put his spirit in it. And he says, you have his mind. And he's there. And many times we have so many benefits in Christ if we'll just use them. Right? And it's so wonderful, and we have peace in that. So I love that. Well, look at 2 Thessalonians back to this message that Paul's telling them about staying on course. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 3, and 4. He says, let no one in any way deceive you, for it will not come unless the apostasy comes first. What won't come? He's not the last days, all right? So he says, it won't come unless the apostasy comes first, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself above every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, displaying himself as being God. So isn't it amazing? Paul, just in a couple verses here, says this is when the Lord's coming. It's simple. It's plain. Quit looking at all these inside lines and all these letters from all these people that they think they got it all explained. He says, look, the apostasy comes first. The great falling away comes first. And he said, until the man of lawlessness is revealed. And he sets himself up in the temple saying that he's God. This is when the end is. He just explains it in two simple verses. Isn't that awesome how God always does it? He does it simply. He doesn't make it complicated, right? I have been in discussions with people before. I've kind of got drawn into them, right? Well, what part are we in the last days? Well, this author says this, and this author says this, and this, you know, this guy, he's a very famous theologian, and he says this is where exactly we're at, and this is when Jesus is coming back, and, you know, we need to be concerned about this. And I'm like, but Jesus said in chapter 24 in Matthew that this is how these events will happen. Well, I know, but this guy, he's just a famous writer. I'm like, He's God. He knows. Okay, why aren't we looking at chapter 24 in Matthew? Well, I know, but with, you know, this author, he's just so good. But Jesus knows, you know. Why aren't we listening to Jesus, right? Because he's got it all. Because his disciples in Matthew chapter 24, they caught him privately, right, on the Mount of Olives. They said, Lord, when will all these things take place? And he lays it out all in beautiful lining, right? Does the Word of God have all these individual underlying details and all these things that some of these men come up with and these people to get people so messed up and off course? No, the Word of God is very plain and true. And if we'll meditate on Him and seek Him and let His Spirit appraise these things, we'll have comfort and peace. And what? He says, what did He say? That if you let all these try to deceive you, or not necessarily deceive, but get you all hung up. He says, like, don't lose your composure. Keep your composure, right? Stay in my word. Stay in truth. Keep your eyes focused on me, right? Don't get off course. Don't be quickly shaken, right? And so how good that is. Paul made it very simple and short. The apostasy first, the great falling away, man of lawlessness revealed. He exalts himself, takes his seat in the temple. And then Paul goes on in this passage. He said, look, the Holy Spirit is restraining this man of lawlessness right now. He says he's being restrained by the Holy Spirit. I like how he goes on. He says, but when this time comes, and I love this, he says, Jesus will slay him with the breath of his mouth. Isn't that awesome? What comes out of his mouth? His word. He'll slay him with his word. That's why the word is so powerful for us, right? That's why it's so good. 2 Timothy 3:16 talks about how good the word of God is for us, all right? Makes us adequate to live for God, right? To serve God. So good. But he's also saying to those who haven't received Christ or the truth about him, says God would send a deluding, he will send a deluding influence so that those people would believe the false thing. So anyone in those times who has not received Christ or the truth of Christ, it says God's going to send a deluding influence over them so they believe what's false. So see how special it is to be selected by God, to be here, to know that he's called you by name, that he has you on this journey, that you will be with him in someday, that he will protect you in such a way that you're not going to have to deal with a deluding influence, that you'll believe everything that's false, right? And so what good news is that? God always makes a way, all right? And so he wants us to stay focused, all right? So let's look on at 2 Thessalonians 2:13 and 14. It says, "But we should always give thanks to God for you, brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God has chosen you from the beginning for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and faith in truth. It was for this he called you through our gospel, that you may gain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ." So he's saying right there, he gave us a very special gift for keeping us on course and in this journey. And he says, it is salvation through sanctification. Man, when I first read the word sanctification, when I was learning the names of God, and I saw it said Jehovah Mekadishkim, and I'm like, who is Jehovah Mekadishkim, and what does that mean? He says, it's the God who sanctifies you. And I don't know, something just churned in my heart. I'm like, oh my goodness, this sanctification, what does it mean? And it's such a beautiful word, and it's a beautiful thing, but it's God always working us. He teaches us, and that he wants us to become more in his image, and that he is forgiving us, and he knows we're going to mess up, but all the time he is there to wanting us to be better and improve. He wants to make us more like himself, and he's showing us that we are work in progress, right? And that we are just, we're humans, like Jack was saying, we are human, and he accepts that, but he's always working through us in that humanity, right, through that person of Christ to sanctify us. And that's really the main point of today, is that's what God uses to keep us on course. We were chosen by him, right? And he gave us his Spirit. But sanctification, the word means set apart. Set apart. And so God has chosen us all. He has set us apart. What? To be holy, all right? So, in other words, well, man, I don't feel holy all the time, and I feel like I fail God, and I'm not as holy. And you're right. You're not. You can't make yourself holy. That's why he sanctifies you, so that he can make you holy for him, right? It's just like, it's the same principle as, okay, so what day did God pick as his special day? The Sabbath, right? That was what? The day he rested, right? But he called it what? He set that day apart, right? The Sabbath for what? Because it was holy. So just as he set the Sabbath apart to be holy, he chose you and I, and he set us apart to be holy for him. Right? He would work, it would be us that he would change and sanctify to be holy. He says, you shall be holy, that's scripture, right? Because he says, I am holy, right? And so he makes us holy to him through sanctification, just like the children of Israel, right? Among many nations, Israel, right? He chose Israel to be his holy people. He set them apart. It's the same principle for you and I. He set us apart to be holy to him. The priest, the Levitical priest, right? They were set apart to be priest, what? To be holy to the Lord, right? And he's doing the same with us. Can you believe, isn't that just amaze you that he would pick us, set us apart to be holy for him? To individual love, the personal, right? The personal influence in that. Look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. It says, in him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise. All right, so you were set apart and you were sealed in the Holy Spirit of promise. Isn't that beautiful? He gave a wonderful process called sanctification. All right, it means set apart. All right, he is the God who sanctifies, not you, okay? All right, he's given grace through that process, right? We mess up at times. He's there to pick us up. He helps us. He teaches us through that. He disciplines us. He chastens us. He tests us, right? All right, he to build us, build character in us, and all that process is called sanctification. Well, I'm just through with that sanctification, brother. No, you'll never be through with sanctification till your day in glory. You will never have perfected this. You know, I'm just going to stop right here. I don't need any more sanctification, Lord. No, he's always wanting to have us in process, in that work in progress. And that's why it's such a beautiful thing as a church being free together, just experiencing God's presence and excited about his love and his word and doing life together, that sanctification is such a beautiful thing, right? Because we're not waiting for someone to mess up, right? We're not looking, I'm just going to watch them to see if they mess up, right? Or what they're doing wrong. No, we always see the good in each other, right? We always believe the best for each other. We know that we have mistakes and faults, right? And so we're able to look over those things because we're all work in progress. But he has set us apart to be holy. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 15. He says, for we are a fragrance of Christ to God. I love that. That goes just perfect. I love what Jack brought to us. But we are a fragrance of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. So he's saying that among those that are being saved, and it's like he's showing there is a process in our salvation. He is saying, you know, work out your own salvation. Do what works for you to stay close to God and to love him and to serve him. We are in a process and we are a work in progress. As he finishes up in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 15 through 17, it says, so then, brethren, stand firm and hold to the traditions which you were taught. So in other words, how do I stay on course? Well, stand firm and hold to the traditions you were taught, whether by word or mouth or by a letter from us. You see how he threw that in there? Make sure it's a letter from us. Make sure it's a letter from the Word of God, not by someone else. It says, now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father. Look at the comfort and the acceptance and just that good Father type love come in through this. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who has loved us and given us eternal comfort and good hope by grace. See him just loving on you and just attaboying you. You can do this. All right? He says, and comfort and strengthen your hearts in every good work and word. So stand firm in the tradition. Now, traditions there, that's precepts. That's the precepts of God. That would be like good doctrine, good biblical truth. Stay in the law of God and his statutes, right? His principles. And keep those traditions strong. Pass them on to your children. This is how you stay on course. Okay? All right? And so I love that. The precepts, the doctrine, God's standard, his word. Actually, Psalm 19 says that his law is perfect in restoring the soul. Isn't that good? So that's God's precepts are... How many of you ever needed your soul restored? He's like, God's precepts, his statutes, his word. That's why I tell you, when I'm down and out, and me and Stacy were talking, the best, you know, how many of you listened to the Bible study Wednesday night? Wasn't it so good? Stacy did such an amazing job. My heart was restored because of the law of God was being taught and preached, and it was just, my soul was being restored through that. And so that's so good. So Paul says, make sure it's a letter from us, and we have to understand how God sees us as his own. I think a lot of times we misunderstand how he sees us. I think a lot of times we think, is he watching us to see if we've done wrong? Right? I'm not threw that in there. He wants to see if we've done wrong and have we messed up. And he's not like that at all. Right? He's always believing the best for us. Right? We're his child, right? We're not trying to, he's not trying to catch us up into something all the time, right? And I was trying to get some clarity to that. And again, I was focusing spiritually because, right, the mind of Christ, right? And I was asking the Lord, you know, explain that. Help me with that, Lord. In our, you know, how do I get that across to people that you're not waiting on us and looking on for something that we're doing wrong all the time, that you're believing the best? And he says, if I were doing that, then why was I walking the earth and believing the best out of everyone? And the Pharisees and scribes were trying to catch everybody doing something wrong. He said, why would I be doing that if that's what they were doing? And I'm like, that's right, Father. You were doing nothing but encouraging people. When you were sitting down with them, you were forgiving them. You were helping them, right? You were teaching them, always teaching, sanctifying, that sanctifying work. I think about my dog Jasper, and I use him a lot of terms. I use pets a lot, but I learn a lot from that, how God wants us to serve him, or how Jesus wants us to see him. I learned a lot of that through my dog. You know, man, he's always waiting for me to get home. All right, he's always wanting to see what I've got in my hand to give him. He's always looking up to see what I've got. I love that principle. He lays at my feet in the office when I'm working. He's just, you know, that if you learn a lot of the ways that Jesus wants us to be with him. And I think about that being set apart. When my last dog had got hit by a car, Stacy got tired of watching me mope for 2 weeks. And so she said, we're going to go look at some dogs. And so she took me to Mineral Wells, and we went and looked at some Boston Terriers there. And so I just loved the guy that was raising them, and I just kind of was, it was really cool. And so he said, well, I've got this mama dog here, and she hadn't had her pups yet, but, you know, she's got this sire, and you know, I'll call you back in a couple weeks. Well, he did, and we came, and they were all females. But my last dog was a male, so I wanted another male. You know, I was stuck in that, and I'm like, oh, I'm bummed out, you know. She didn't have any male dogs, you know. Now I got to wait another 2-3 weeks or whatever till your another dog has pups, you know. And so we're getting ready to leave, and we're watching all these dogs that he has out there. And then there's one dog that's, I don't know, how old was he? Maybe 2 or 3 weeks old. But he was sitting kind of in a hole, and all these other dogs were at the fence saying, pick me, you know. But he was over there sitting by himself in a hole. And he caught my eye, and he caught Stacy's eye. I'm like, what's going on with that dog over there sitting in that hole by himself? And the guy says, well, you know, I had a lady that was supposed to come get him, and she canceled. And then this other lady canceled. And then there's another lady supposed to come this morning. She had a car wreck. And she's like, she wasn't able to come. I'm like, and I just felt like, the Lord said, that's your dog. You know, and so we picked him. And I thought, wow, what a beautiful picture how God does us, how he sets us apart. Jasper was set apart. Right? And so what I would take him home, and he's like, yeah, I get to ride in the front seat with y'all in Stacy's arms. And we grow and raised him, right? And he's just saying, like a lot of times when us, look, God, I'm sitting in a hole by myself and I need your help. And that's kind of how he does it. All right, I'm here to sanctify you. Right? Now, when I'm gone at work, I'm not saying, what's Jasper up to now? What's he chewed up? Or what's he torn up? What's he slept on? No, what am I thinking about him? I'm like, I can't wait to get home to see Jasper. He's waiting for me at the door. In fact, when I get out of the truck, he knows the sound of my truck pulling in the alley. He's going to be crying for me at the door when I close my door in my truck. See, that's how God sees us, right? He wants us to yearn for Him, but He's not thinking all these bad things. I wonder what they're doing all day. He thinks of the good things that we do. Right? I know Jasper's going to want something from my hand. I know he's going to want to lay at my feet tonight. I know he's going to want to follow me all around the house, wherever I go. That's how God sees us, and He sanctifies us through that process. It's such a beautiful thing. He's not condemning and always want us to mess up. He's always seeing the good things, right? He's not always over us shaking that finger. He loves us so much, and you need to understand how much He loves. So this is how we stay on course. You got to believe you're in sanctification. You got to believe you're work in process. You got to believe that God loves you and He thinks the best for you. Right, you're going to mess up, and He'll discipline us as His child, not someone He doesn't like. He disciplines us like He's someone He loves. All right, and He'll correct us because He wants us to continue to grow. Amen. Well, God bless you. We'll be going back to Sundays, full service next week, and let's pray for His help for all of us. Right, Father, we thank You. We thank You for this amazing gift of sanctification. We thank You so much that You're always seeing the goodness, always appraising or seeing us through Christ, that You're always looking through Christ when You look at us. And that's really something that's hard to understand, Lord. But whether we're in the spirit or we're in the natural or the physical, Lord, You always see us through the lens of Jesus Christ. And we're so grateful that it's really a good thing that we don't understand how deep Your love is. We really don't understand how deep Your mercy is and Your grace. But thank You that it's there. Thank You that You are available for us to tap in to Your grace and Your mercy, Your salvation, Your love. You're always there to sanctify us. And Lord Jesus, as You prayed in Your great high priestly prayer, that we would be sanctified in truth. So thank You for showing us that it's always done by the truth of Your word. Lord, help anyone calling upon You right now, Lord. You know what's going on in their heart. You know, Lord, what they need. And Lord, you're just so moved by those who want You and need You and call out to You. And Lord, You're there. And so we thank You in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.